Ready? Okay. Good morning, Encounter Fam Bam.
What is going on? How are y'all doing this morning? Happy Father's
Day.
Yes,
happy Father's Day. Yes, and it is like sun is out. It is already 90,000 degrees outside.
Yes, we are giving away root beer.
Yes,
morning,
and a little Father's Day gift.
Yes, and we have like a grill, like a gift package with like bar nuts and like
root beer.
Root beer, new tongs. Everybody wants a new grill and some new tongs for Father's
Yes.
Day.
Yes. So if you're not here now, get here for second service. It starts at 11. If this is your first time connecting with us, please text the word connect to
501-510-6020. Please text it. Like, we need you to text this number right now.
Yeah. Yes, we need it right now. So it is Father's Day, and you are a father.
How
many kids do you have?
Two.
Two? How old are they?
9 and 9 months.
Yes.
I know, right?
Like, and if you've never seen these babies, they look identical.
Yes, they do.
They look identical, 9 years apart.
Yes.
What is your favorite dad joke?
My favorite dad joke, I'm not the best dad joke guy, but I would say my favorite dad joke would probably be, I'm worried about the calendar.
Why?
Because its days are numbered.
Okay. That one's kind of funny. It's kind of,
you know,
it's kind of
I
funny.
Just keep them coming all day.
But the thing is that you were so serious. I was like, wait, is there a reason to be worried? Like, I need more coffee. All right. If you could describe fatherhood with three words, what would it be?
I think if I could describe fatherhood with three words, it would be probably provider, protector, and priest. I think as a father, those are three of the best words that I could use to describe what I strive for in my family to be a father, because we have to provide for our family, we have to protect our family, and we have to be the priest, you know what I mean?
That is so good. Those are the best words for it, because that is, like, the father is the head of the household in the Bible. That's what it says. And so that is amazing. And
yeah.
I love that. We hope you all are having a great Father's Day. If you're like me, my dad passed away in 2008, and so it's always like a little jab that he's not here, but
then you have all those awesome memories.
Yes.
You know
yes.
what I mean?
Yeah. Yes. I do. I was telling my oldest the other day about a story, and I've lived with it my whole life. So I was 17 when my dad died, and he used to say, if it bothers you enough to make you upset, do something about it.
Yeah.
Every time. So now I say that all the time. So anytime I think about something that bothers me, it's like, yeah, poor Dayton. Like, he gets me as a mom, though.
Yeah.
You're welcome, child. Yeah. You're welcome. All right, y'all. It is time to get our worship on. I heard them practicing. It is incredible.
It's gonna be awesome. It really is.
Yes. We hope to see y'all later. Bye.
Bye. Love you guys.
Love you.
Happy Father's Day.
Yes.
Good morning, everybody. Hey, where are the dads at today? Yeah. Happy Father's Day, everybody. If you stand to your feet, let's get ready to worship God. You know how we do.
I've tried so hard to see it. Took me so long to believe. Choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve.
Oh,
the power of your name, I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated with the one who has conquered it all.
Amen. Hallelujah. Father God, we come to you right now. Just thank you that you did conquer it all. And because you are victorious, we can be victorious. We can't even live and breathe without you, Father. And every day we wake up, we give thanks to you, Father, for giving us that freedom, giving us that victory, because you are the victory. In Jesus' name, hallelujah. We see you.
This is would you just look at him, look at him?
Look at him,
would you just look at him, look at him?
Look at him,
would you just look at him, look at him?
His eyes like fire.
Would you just look at him, look at him?
His hair like wool.
Would you just look at him, look at him?
His feet like brass.
How many of you know that God is taking you from a pit to where you are now? Like, man, when I think about my life and I think where I was 15 years ago, you know, I can't help but forget. And I can never forget what he's done for me and taking me from where I was then to where I am now. Man, such an awesome song. Great job, guys. Can we give this worship team a round of applause? Man, they did an awesome job this morning. Hey, can we also give it up for our fathers this morning? It's Father's Day. I gotta I got on my dad t-shirt. My buddy John Thomas gave this to me when he moved off to Louisiana Tech. I love you, John Thomas. If you're watching this morning, shout out to John Thomas for giving me this dad shirt. But this morning we're here to celebrate our Heavenly Father, right? That's why we're here this morning. And I'm so glad that you guys have joined us here to celebrate Father's Day and to worship God. And man, I'm so grateful for a room full of dads. Like, Father's Day is supposed to be one of the most least attended Sundays at church. And look around this room. Like, that means that some of the fathers at Encounter Church have got their priorities straight, right? Like, I am so glad that we have a church full of dads who said, I'm not going fishing. I'm taking my family to hear about Jesus. I'm so grateful that we have a room full of dads who value God above all else in their lives. Hey, guys, if it is your first time to be here with us this morning, I'd ask that you notice in your seat back in front of you, there is a Connect card that looks just like this. Take that out, fill it out, and turn it into the Welcome Center on your way out. That way we can get connected with you. We just want to get to know your name and put a face with this card. So make sure you turn that in on your way out. We actually have a gift for you this morning as well. So make sure you take that and turn it in. If you are online, let us know in the comments that this is your first time with us watching on our online campus. You can also text CONNECT to 501-510-6020. Also, on the back of here, you'll notice that there is a place for prayer requests. If you would take this and fill this out, y'all, I cannot stress to you how important prayer is to us here at Encounter Church. You know, as one of the service pastors here at Encounter, we have these prayer requests. And me and my wife were just sitting on the couch this week praying together for these prayer requests. And I'm telling you, man, there's a lot of needs out there. And in one way, my heart was breaking just to see all the need that we had. But in another way, I was celebrating because I know that when we stand in faith together, that God still moves and he still does miracles and he changes people's lives. So it is important that we take these and fill them out so that we can be praying for you guys throughout the week. This week, I've been texting back and forth with a couple of my buddies, Brandon over here in the drum cage, and Colton probably somewhere in here. And we were texting back and forth about this message. And it's from Pastor Stephen Chandler. If you have never listened to Stephen Chandler, listen to him. He's a great pastor. But in this message, he said something that really hit home with me. He said that a lot of us as Christians are living our lives through a secondhand relationship with God. Like, when I thought about that, it really impacted me, and it really made me think. It kind of just slapped me upside the head and said, what areas of my life am I living a secondhand relationship with God? Like, you know, have you ever got tired of just seeing people be blessed? You know what I mean? Have you ever not get tired of seeing them be blessed, but ask God, like, why not me? You know? And it's because you don't have that firsthand relationship with him. Like, whether that's through tithing or serving or whatever God's calling you to do this morning, I'd ask you, don't have that secondhand relationship with him. Have that firsthand relationship with him this morning. And anybody want a firsthand blessing in this room? Amen. So this morning, our ushers are going to come forward and get ready to serve you. They're going to take up our tithe and offering. We have five easy ways to give here at Encounter Church. You can text the amount to 84321. You can give online at encounterchurch.tv. You can give on the mobile app. You can give cash and check or at the giving kiosk at the Welcome Center. Father God, we thank you so much for this day, Father. We thank you for everything that you've done for us, Lord. We thank you for the fact that you have taken us from the pit to where we are now, Lord. And I thank you for the future growth that you're going to bring in our lives, God. I thank you for this message that James is going to bring this morning, God, and I ask that you would just give us hearts to receive this morning. Father, I ask that you would bless and that you would take it and use it for what you have it deemed for. In Jesus' name, amen.
Spirits out rushing with sin, revival ever smoldering. Breath of God, fan us into flame. And we need a fresh wind, the fragrance of heaven. Pour your spirit out, pour your spirit out.
Thank you for your grace, for your mercy, for your presence. God, we thank you for your spirit that is in this place, that fresh wind of the spirit. God, I thank you, even in our toughest days, our best days, that there's a moving of your spirit that is available to our life. And so, God, we lean into you right now. We honor you. We thank you for your grace and your mercy and your presence that never leaves us and never forsakes us. Seated, look at somebody next to them and tell them happy Father's Day, whether you're a father or not. We are here to celebrate all of our fathers today, and there are three groups of fathers here I want to celebrate today. There are people who are currently fathers. You got your kids here with you, or maybe your kids are living in another town and they've got grandkids for you and all that good stuff, and we honor you. We've got some people here who have lost their children, who are today maybe a time of grieving, and I want you to know that we're here for you, and we honor you, and we love you, and we support you. And even though today may not be a day of celebration for you, we want you to know that we're in your corner, and we're praying for God's blessing and favor for you. And there's some of you guys that are fathers, but you don't have natural kids, but you've got all kinds of kids. Like you have poured into the lives of another generation, and maybe it's because you're not married yet, maybe you just don't have kids, or maybe you've been trying for a while and you still don't have kids, but man, you have been pouring your life into some people, and so I want to honor you today. Can we just take a second and honor our dads today? Thank you guys so much to everyone that is here, but the greatest honor on Father's Day, quite honestly, goes to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and so can we give our Heavenly Father the biggest happy Father's Day ever? Thank you. Now, I will say, and we debated this year, I got to be honest, we have done what I'm getting ready to do right now for 7 years in a row, 6 years in a row. It's been a while. The problem is it becomes like Charlie Brown Christmas. After a while, you just have to watch it. Like, it's not Christmas without it, and the same thing is true today. So we debated and we argued, went back and forth. I actually put out a little bit of an informal survey to some dads and said, what do you think? And they said, we cannot have Father's Day without dad life.
This is dad life. It's how we live 24/7, 365. Check me. Gas station glasses, don't care what the masses think about me with my sweet goatee. I'm rocking my Dockers with a cuff and a crease. I got that St. John's Bay and the clip for my piece. I look nice. I got dozens of dollars and that's right. It goes straight to my daughters and my wife. I'm a miracle dad, making magic with the checkbook is a talent I have. I roll hard in the yard with a 60-inch cut. Zero turn radius, my neighbors say, what? They be driving by, peeping my landscape. Yo, these greens got nothing on my manscape.
Hydrangeas, what? Begonias, no. Crepe myrtles,
ornamental turtle.
Hold up, is that a weed in my fescue?
Oh, no, Roundup to the rescue. It's the dad life, it's the dad life. Take my daughter to the party, it's the dad life. It's the dad life, it's the dad life. Shooting vids of the kids, it's the dad life. Roll up to the splash pad, 10 a.m. My whole entourage hops out the minivan. We splishy splashy for an hour or two. Then it's back to the house, yeah. Prepping for the barbecue.
Brats, dogs, rack of ribs, whatever. Get me on the Weber, man, nobody does it better. Call me Lord of the Grill, I'm king of the coals. Nana's secret recipe, you know how I roll.
1080p, 16 by 9. I'm rocking man cave status with a screen like mine. Keep your peanut butter hands off my 50-inch Vizio. Pop up the corn, roll the Disney video.
Don't you dare close your eyes.
We got Aladdin, Jasmine, Abu, the genie. Hey. With kids like mine, everybody wants to be me.
Sing the nightlight song, you kids off to bed.
This is the dad life, no more to be said.
It's the dad life, hey. It's the dad life. Oh. Hit the mall, coaching ball. It's the dad life, it's the dad life, hey. It's the dad life. Oh. Playing rough, fixing stuff. It's the dad life, it's the dad life, it's the dad life. Yeah, you know how we do it, it's the dad life.
Wow, sometimes this church just gets weird. Okay, so we've got a gift we're going to give to some a dad today. Dayton and Michaela are going to help me out real quick. We've got a little tailgate kit here, and Michaela is going to pull out a name or a number for me. We're going to read it off. Is that all right? Turn that thing around where they can see it. All they see is the back. Now they're going to have your back. Look at that. We got root beer, and we got utensils, and we got a grill, and we got some beer nuts and all kinds of cool stuff. Are you ready? Our dad's ready? Woo! Are you ready? Is she ready? Okay, do it this time. Nah. Okay, here we go. You can hold that now. Thank you. Why is my name on here? Why does this one have no number? Oh, there it is. You know why there's no number? There they are. Look at that. Numbers. All right. Number 1, 9, 1. Woo! 7. Woo! 9. Woo! 1. Oh my God. Randy. Randy, you've been here since launch. Is this the first time you've won anything? My Lord. See, if you hang out long enough, you will eventually win. Give it up for Randy. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Wow. Okay, so a couple announcements real quick, and then I got some jokes. You can't have Father's Day without dad jokes. VBS is coming up real quick. All the information for VBS will be on the website this evening and tomorrow. You can register tomorrow online if you want to send your kids to VBS, or you can text the word, is it just VBS? VBS to 510-6020. There you go. See, I knew what I was doing. 510-6020. You can text the word if you want to register your kids for VBS, elementary school kids. If you've got some high school kids, man, they would love to have them serve. And here's what you can do if you're an adult or if you're a teenager would like to serve, go to the Welcome Center, and they will get you set up with how to get registered to serve. We got to do background checks and all that stuff if you're over 18, so we want to make sure that happens quickly. And so you can do that. And we're going to have a bunch of kids this year, guys. So this is the first year coming out of COVID to have VBS. We did not get to have it last year, so we want to make sure that we do that well. And then worship night is next Sunday night. Everybody say next Sunday night. First worship night of 2021. We got food trucks. We got an after party. We got a guest speaker. And I promise you it's going to be a night you do not want to forget, will not forget. Be here on the 27th. It's going to be great. And then the last thing I want to do real quick before we tell some jokes and get into a message is we've got a bunch of teenagers going to camp this afternoon. Come on, give it up. If you are a volunteer or a teenager and you're headed to camp this afternoon, could you stand to your feet real quick? I want to take a moment. I want to pray for you because you're going to need all the prayer you can get. Come on, if you're a teenager or a volunteer. All right, we got about 25 that are going to camp. We got a bunch serving all over the place. Let's take a moment. Let's just pray for them that are going, that God would bless them, give them safety and protection, but more importantly, that they would come back next Sunday and absolutely wreck this place. God, we thank you so much for our volunteers that are going to take all of these kids to camp. They're going to take 20-plus kids, almost 25 kids to camp. They're going to be just serving them and mentoring them. God, we ask you to give them, first off, a ton of patience. We ask you to just touch them and bless them for giving their time and effort and energy and sacrificing that to volunteer for such an amazing event. God, we ask you to touch every teenager that is going. God, we ask you to let this be a life-altering, life-changing event. Let teenagers come back from this event on fire for you, committed to you, and ready to turn the world upside down. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Amen. Give it up for our teenagers again. You're going to start seeing these again next week, Hot Springs Village. We're a couple weeks out from the next meet and greet, so you'll see those on your seats next week. It's going to be a great time together, but here's a couple jokes for you before we get into this thing. Which bear is the most condescending? A panda. Duh. What? See, all the dads are like, yeah, I get it. What kind of noise does a witch's vehicle make? Vroom, vroom, vroom. What's brown and sticky? A stick. Two guys walked into a bar. Third guy ducked. Thank you, thank you, thank you. How do you get a country girl's attention? A tractor. Why are elevator jokes so classic and good? They work on many levels. You want one more? What do you call a pudgy psychic? A fortune teller. Well, yeah, that too. What did the police officer say to his belly button? Brian, come on, what'd he say? You're under a vest. That's funny right there. Okay, the theme for today, Brian, you liked that, didn't you? You're going to use that tomorrow, aren't you? Yes, yes, he is. Okay, the theme for the day is man of the hour. I want you guys to know, every guy that is here, and you are the man of the hour. You have been created, purposed, and designed for such a time as this. In fact, in the book of Esther, which is always read specifically for ladies, because Esther was obviously a lady, but I believe that the statement that was made about her can apply to us today. In Esther 4:14, it says, if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. In other words, God's going to find somebody to bring deliverance for his people. He's going to use somebody, but you and your family, stop for a second right there. God's going to use somebody to bring revival and deliverance and see a world saved. But for you and your family, it's up to you. And who knows that, but you have come to this position, the place where you are, for such a time as this. In our society right now, this is the only thing political I'm going to say all day long, and I don't talk political very much, but the only thing political, in our society right now, it is cool to make sure the guys feel very emasculated. We are trying our best to eliminate manhood from society. Okay? You know it, and I know it. You see it. Anything that is distinct about genders is being removed. Everybody is equal and the same. Now, I do believe everybody is equal when it comes to rights. I believe everybody is equal when it comes to treatment. I believe everybody are equal when it comes to respect. But men and women are distinctly different. Created to be so. So while I love all you ladies, you had your day last month with Deidre. I want to talk to the guys today because I believe that there are specifically some guys in this room, whether you're a dad or not, and ladies as well, this will apply to you, so don't turn it off. You can take some notes. There's going to be some stuff that you're going to get out of this too. Because I believe every single individual that's in this room is here for a specific reason and a specific season. God has put you where you are right now. Now, there would have been easier seasons to have been born in. God knows I can think of a few I would have rather been trying to lead through. This is not the easiest season to be a dad. It's not the easiest season to be a guy. It's not the easiest season to be a pastor. It's not the easiest season to be a Christian. But you've been chosen for such a time as this. And God has given you everything you need to lead as the man that you are in your manhood today, right now. He's given you everything you need right now. And so my title today within this whole man of the hour theme that we've been doing is the power of one man. Ladies, the power of one woman. The power of one. The power of one person, one individual. I want to read to you from Romans chapter 5. And then I'm going to give you some examples of some normal dads, normal men who changed the world. Romans 5:17, for this by the trespass of the one man, everybody say one man, We know that is Adam, because Adam messed up, death reigned through that one man. How much more will those who receive God's abundant provision of grace and of the gift of righteousness reign in life through the one man, Jesus Christ? Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people. For just as through the disobedience of one man, the many were made sinners, so also through the obedience of one man, the many will be made righteous. Everybody say, the power of one. Adam brings sin and death into the world. Now let me give all the ladies a little bit of a shout out. It was not Eve that brought sin and death into the world. Everybody wants to blame Eve, but Adam made the choice too. And the Bible distinctly places the burden of proof on Adam. Because of the sin of one man, death comes into the world. But Proverbs 18:21 says that you have the power of life and death in the words that you speak. So you have the ability in and of yourself right now to change the course of history. Jesus came ultimately to change and correct the decision that Adam made, the vast, horrendous mistake that Adam made. Jesus came in and he turned the course of history. And I know what you're thinking right now. Well, that was Jesus. Of course he could change the world. Of course he could turn everything upside down and rewrite history. He was Jesus. But I want to tell you that you have the ability right now, as a dad, as a man, as a human in Hot Springs, Arkansas, to make a significant impact in your own world. The Old Testament is littered, I mean literally scattered with men specifically, but people who through one decision, one effort, basically getting tired and frustrated of where things are, changed their world. When I say some of these names, there are going to be some images pop in your mind, maybe Bible stories from your past, maybe some memes or something from social media, or maybe just the legends that you have heard, but some of people like Jonah and the whale. We heard a story this week of a real-life guy that was swallowed by a whale and spit up, and everybody said throughout the years it's absolutely impossible. That could have never happened, and yet it happened last week, so that's cool. But because of his decision, he made a bad decision first that ended up inside of a whale, and then he makes a good decision. Because of a good decision, an entire city turns and follows God. A guy by the name of Noah who did the opposite. He made a good decision first and then a bad decision. His good decision first was he chose to honor God and follow God, be faithful to God, builds an ark, saves his family. Then he comes off the ark and he decides party time and he gets wasted. Maybe not the best decision to make after God just delivers you, but you know, that's what he did. But normal people God uses. A guy by the name of Joseph. Joseph was a guy that got the coat of many colors. You know what Joseph's problem was? Joseph was a little arrogant. Some of y'all would add another word after that word arrogant, but that's what Joseph was. He was a little spoiled. But God took that spoiled and turned him into a leader. And because of one man, he saved an entire generation from famine. Paul, greatest apostle ever, started out killing Christians. But because of a decision he made in his life, he becomes the greatest influence on Christianity, save Jesus himself. James, I mean, he was just a great guy. I don't even need to say more about him. Peter, I mean, Peter speaks the first message on the day of Pentecost and turns an entire course of history because of one good decision. Now, he made three bad decisions before that, four if you count cutting off the guy's ear, but because you know Jesus calls him Satan at that point, so that's pretty much a bad decision. But he takes four bad decisions in a row and turns him into the guy who speaks the very first message, the very first gospel message. And I know you're saying, wait a minute, just like Jesus, that was Jesus, he could turn the world upside. These are the biblical guys. Like, these are the guys. Of course they turned the world upside down. But what about, man, I'm just a normal person. What do you expect me to do? you look at modern history, there's some normal guys turn the world upside down. See how many of these you can recognize. Anybody recognize this guy? This guy couldn't even, was not a natural dad. He was a stepdad. But he also became the father of a nation. But he was just a normal guy. He was a normal guy that fought in a war, became a surveyor. Nothing spectacular about him, and yet he became spectacular. One man willing to face down the most powerful nation in the world at its time. What about this guy? Anybody know him? What's his name? Winston Churchill. If you know anything about Winston Churchill, he literally was the only person fighting on a small island by himself and nobody else was with him. Well, we were with him. We're the United States of America. We were not. He called begging for help and we told him no. He needed to have some airplanes that they'd already bought delivered so that they could fight the war. And you know what Roosevelt told him? We'll take them from about a mile from Canada. You can send horses over and pull them across the border. That's how much help we gave him. We wouldn't even let him put him on a truck. And yet this one man, well, go back. Don't get ahead of me. This one man faces down the Nazi regime and Hitler. And because of him, and ultimately because of America's input, but because of him, defeated one of the worst enemies in world history. And then the next guy you just saw, what's his name? Martin Luther King. One man becomes a figurehead, becomes the image of an unjust system that had been going on probably since the beginning of time, but he said enough's enough. Gave the ultimate price, his life for a dream and for a cause. And because of that, we're able to literally celebrate Juneteenth weekend and the freedom and the advancements. We're nowhere near where we need to be, guys, but we've seen some amazing advancements because one man with a dream, inspiring millions. The next guy is one of my personal favorites. What's his name? Reagan. He's literally the greatest president of my generation. You guys may argue differently, maybe because you were younger and you didn't know Reagan. That's the only reason. You just don't have the right information. This is a man that stared down the Cold War, Soviet Union, communism, that was spreading throughout the world and literally broke down a wall that divided a nation in two and put the nation of Germany back together and ended the Cold War and did so with words. One man. Everybody say one man. But wait, Pastor James, wait a second. I'm still like, okay, those are great people, but those were great people. So your excuse is I'm not Jesus, so I can't do anything. I'm not the Old Testament, New Testament Bible people, so I can't really do anything. I'm not these great politicians, so I can't do anything. But what about this guy? What about one man that is willing to stand up on a stage and worship and to lead people in a place of worship and to lead his home well, that loves God, that is a grandfather to some boys that needed a male figure in their life that are not his natural grandkids, and yet he still took them as his. What about this guy right here that you've already seen today? Or what about this guy right here? Now hold on right there just for a second, Jessica. I could keep going on and on and on with some of the pictures of you guys, and I don't mean to have anybody left out. But there's another one man that made a decision that caused us to be here today, and that's this guy. That's my dad. See, what you may not know about my dad is I was born James Eugene Christian Matthews. They apparently had more names than I needed, but they decided to give them all to me anyway. The problem with Calvin Matthews was that Calvin Matthews was a drug addict. Heroin specifically, really liked heroin, put him in the hospital, bad needles, all this stuff. And at that point, my mom decided, I'm out because I'm not raising my son like this. And my mom meets Don Turner, who then adopts a one-year-old that was not his and raises him in church. Now, but we got to, let's be fair. There was also a person before him, and this is a shout out to our ladies real quick. That's my grandmother. My grandmother led him to Christ. And if we really got really picky, I could go back even farther than that to a little small church in Middletown, Ohio, where a guy named Heidebaugh led a family to church. Or I could go back even farther than that, and we can continue to find one man who led one man who led one man. But here's the deal. One person made a decision to adopt a one-year-old who, after hearing the gospel message of Jesus Christ, and because of that, now we're sitting here today and Encounter Church is here because of one man. What can one... But he didn't start like that. Let's skip two pictures for me, Jessica. Skip two pictures. Skip my grandmother real quick and go to the hippie. Give me the hippie picture. There he is. See, that's what he looked like at my parents' wedding, which I happened to be in attendance of. He was a hippie that just started to know Jesus. Now, there's nothing wrong with being a hippie necessarily, but like, he was a hippie. There's one more picture I want to put up here real quick. You guys will know this guy right here. Who is that? And hold on right there for a minute, Jessica. Billy Graham, arguably, has reached more people. Bill Bright is the only person that's even in the running. Started Campus Crusade for Christ, a couple other things. But Billy Graham, arguably the most effective evangelist of the 20th century and the beginning of the 21st century. Reach more people, arguably, for Christ than any other person. Bill Bright would be the next person. Save Jesus and Paul. Okay? But you know who the one man was that saved him? Some of you might. Most of you don't. It was this guy right here. This guy, his name is Mordecai Ham. He was preaching a convention, conference, event, revival service, where Billy Graham, as a young man, gave his life to Christ. Now, this guy is not in the Bible. This guy is not somebody that everybody talks about in church history. And yet, because of one man who was seemingly insignificant, we have Billy Graham. So what about you? Will you be the man of the hour for your family? Because maybe you're raising the next Billy Graham. Will you be the man of the hour for your wife? Will you be the man of the hour for your children? Will you be the man of the hour on your job? Because you don't know who is working with you, beside you, or for you, that the influence that they're going to have on another generation. There's a statement that was made in the, I've been watching a lot of things about Winston Churchill here lately. He's just captured my attention. And this statement was made about him. When history was hanging in the balance, it was always up to a single man to make the difference. When history is hanging in the balance, it's always up to a single man to make the difference. My favorite quote ever, period, in all of history, is a guy by the name of Edmund Burke. He said, "All it takes for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing." Uncle Sam has the next best statement. All I'm looking for is a few good men. You know what I'm looking for today? One guy. One guy that will say, enough's enough. In my family, the enemy has plagued it enough. In my job, in my life, enough is enough. I'm going to be the man of the hour in my own life. Why? Because God's already equipped you to do it. You have been placed here today. I've got a journal that I got years back, I don't even remember, probably 5-6 years back, just a little pocket journal on the front. It says, the place where you are right now, God circled it on the map for you. The place where you are right now, God circled it for you right now. Well, I hate where I am right now. God circled it for you to be an impact where you are. Does that mean he wants you to stay in the place where you are emotionally, financially, even maybe physically forever? Not necessarily. In fact, what he's placed you there for is to make a difference where you are right now. You have two choices today. You accept what's there, or you say, I'm going to man up. I'm going to make a change. How do we do that? How do we make a change in our world? Here's the first one. You put
God first. Listen to me, dads in your home, put God first. Not Hulu, not Netflix, not Fortnite, God. You put God first. You put God first. Let me say it with another emphasis. You put God first. Because here's the reality. If God's not first, he's not there. In fact, he says, have no other gods before me. God is very, very jealous. God is very, very specific that you are placing him first in your life or he has no place in your life. Matthew 6:33, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. And then there's this amazing, amazing promise. And all of these things will be added to you. If you ask, what are all these things? Read the verses prior. He talks about food and clothing and shelter. He talks about all of these things. He said, but if you'll seek me first, all that stuff will take place. The problem is, guys, we have this natural inclination to seek that stuff first, and then we put God on the burner. We're Sunday morning. Let's go punch our time clock, get it over with, get it done. That's why, honestly, in most churches around the world, Father's Day is the second least attended Sunday in the year. Because Mother's Day, for whatever reason, moms want all their babies at church. Let's get pictures together. Let's come in your Sunday best. We do big photo booths for Sunday. You know what we do for Mother's Day? You know what we do for Dad's Day? We do an arrow. Because dads don't want pictures. Some of y'all do. You're weird. We're not picture people. We're like, you see all these ladies taking selfies, and every once in a while you'll see a dude taking a selfie, and you're like, really? Must be a really good day. It's just not who we are. It's not what we do. Naturally, we force ourselves to smile. It's like, what would happen if we put God first, put the house of God first? What would happen if we sought him first? Second thing, what that means for us to be the man of the hour and to make an impact in our world is we walk by faith and not by sight. In fact, 2 Corinthians 5:7 says, for we walk by faith and not by sight. You know what that means? That means when you're struggling, you don't get to a place where you're the one leading your family in doubt, but you're leading your family in faith. That means when you're having a tough time with your kids, you don't lead in doubt, you lead in faith. That means when you walk in the door, we talked about last week that you don't start from a place of what I don't have, you start from a place of what I do have. I don't have much. I can focus on that, or I can say, but God, you've blessed me so much more than the vast majority of the world today. Start from a place of faith. Third and last thing, we're going to close with this, is you're holy. 1 Peter 1:16 says, be holy because I am holy. Holiness is a word that has been ascribed and even hijacked by a specific group of people, group of Christian or denomination. Well, they are holiness. It doesn't even make sense. Holiness is not limited to a group of people in a specific denomination. Holiness is a lifestyle. Holiness is not dress length or hair length. Holiness is not whether or not you have a tattoo. Holiness is not whether or not you eat meat or not. Holiness is not whether or not, that's not holiness. Those are things that you do because God has convicted you of a certain thing and you feel like this is something I'm doing to God as a sacrifice. By all means, do it. Holiness literally means, let me give you the action. This is not deep dive theology right here. This is Strong's Concordance. Holiness means pure or one thing. It comes from the same root and kind of beginning infancy in language as the word integrity. In other words, when I serve God, I do it with all that I am all the time. That's holiness. Holiness says, God, there's never a time where, hey, I'm off today. Or I'm really, really pure when I'm at church for an hour. But, man, you don't want to see me on Friday night when I'm getting crunk. It's not pure. Pure says I'm the same. You know what that word pure means? The one thing? It means that it's not diluted, or it is diluted, but it's not polluted. That's the word I'm looking for. There's not other things that are allowed to creep in. Dads, you want to know what's hurt our witness? We allow a lot of other things creeping in. I've heard recently, as recent as this week, a lot of other things people have allowed to creep in. And I've heard people celebrate them as manhood. Being a womanizer does not define you as a man. An alcoholic doesn't define you as a man. Being a workaholic doesn't define you as a man. What defines you a man is you've been made in the image of God. Not because you're male. Females are made in the image of God too. He created them, male and female, in his image. Okay? This is not gender, whatever. But I am talking to the guys for a second. I want you guys to understand everything you need, God gave you the moment that you took your first breath. And everything you've needed since then, he has given you at the moment you need it. If you don't have it right now, it's because you do not need it to fulfill his purpose in your life today. Stop waiting for something else and lean into him. Put him first. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Walk into your home and be the light and example for your kids of what a godly man looks like. Quite honestly, drive some stuff out of your house. Put God first. One of the things that every single one of the people that we talked about had in common, every one of them, is they sacrificed something for what was more important. Washington put his freedom on the line, his quote-unquote citizenship on the line. Martin Luther King Jr. sacrificed his life. Every one of them, they put something, their reputation for an idea. What is God placing in your life? Pastor James, that's going to cost me something. Anything worth having is worth paying. Brings us to the ultimate decision a man needs to make. That is to follow the greatest man that's ever lived. You see, you cannot be the man that God's called you to be. You can't be the man of purpose and faith and vision. You can't be the dad and the husband that God's called you to be without the Spirit of God in your life. Oh, you can try, and you can do a really good job to a certain extent. There are many, many great men who do not know Jesus. There are many great fathers who don't know Jesus. They're just good dads. There's really great husbands that don't know Jesus. But man, how much better could they be if they had the anointing of God present in their life? You know what the anointing of God does? Anointing is a good Christian word. We talked about it last week. It just means the presence of God in your life. It's referring to the old anointing oil, and if you want more about that, you can listen to last week's message. It's allowing it to come into your life and be present. And here's how it takes place. Back to Peter, the guy that gives the first gospel message. He said it like this. He said, repent, baptize, receive the Spirit. First step today is to say, Jesus, I'm sorry for the sins that I've done, the things that I've done to offend you, to offend my family, even offend my own self. There's some things Paul says that there are sins of the flesh that they're against yourself. You know what the only enemy is that will defeat you? Chisholm sent me this text this week and I thought it was phenomenal. He said, steel is impervious to anything. Outside forces can't affect it. The only thing that can destroy steel is itself. It rusts. Now there are elements that cause that rust, but you can melt steel. It's right back. You can do a lot of things to steal, but there's only one thing that will destroy it when it begins to corrode on itself. You know, you're your worst enemy. And in fact, the only enemy that can destroy you is you. So we make a decision today, guys, that we're not going to allow the things that are around us to cause us to turn on ourselves. But we're going to rise up. We're going to make a decision. We're going to do what God's called us to do. We're going to be the men God's called us to. every head bowed, every eye closed, I want you just to take 1 second. I want you to think of the dream that God's placed in your life. Here's what I know about every guy. Every guy's got a dream for something. Every guy's got a hope of something. Maybe you want to get a raise on your job. Maybe you want to get promoted on your job. Maybe you want to, whatever. Every single guy in this room has a desire for something. That is innate part of us. What would happen if we took that vision, that dream, and that scope, and we put it underneath the umbrella of the authority of God? How much more can that be with His blessing, His favor? So God, right now, I pray for all of our guys. I pray for every single person that's in this room, but I pray for our men on their day today. We started this message with talking about the three groups of fathers that we have in this room. And so, God, first off, I pray for our dads who have children at home, or maybe they're grandfathers and their kids have moved out, but they have biological children that they are or were responsible for. And so, God, I ask you to bless them right now with wisdom, direction, and favor. Open doors for them that they can continue to serve. God, let them serve you first. To model in front of their children what it means to be a godly man. God, for the second group of men that we referred to earlier, those who have lost a child, maybe they were parents and they're not now, maybe through life and circumstance, their children are no longer with us today. God, I ask you right now first to give them the strength that they need, the peace that passes understanding. No parent should ever outlive their child. And yet, God, we know that happens. And so I ask you to touch every dad that is in this room that has happened to. Give them your peace and your strength and your love. Wrap your arms around them today and know, let them know that they are not alone. But they have you, they have us. We're in this thing together. The third group, God, to those who have no biological children, maybe they feel like George Washington, that they've invested into someone else's kids or even a group of people and their kids. God, I ask you to encourage them and let them know that their effort is not for naught, that they have influenced the lives of many people. And we call them dads today because they have a passion that goes beyond themselves. God, I ask you to touch our moms today, our ladies that are in the house. God, I ask you to let them be the helpmeets that you've called them to be, to help all these guys that are in this room out, because God knows we need all the help we can get. There was a reason you put us around some ladies that could be able to lift us up. Not because we're the dominant. Usually it's because we're not. And we need support. God, I ask you to let every guy in this room know that there is support, that there is love through your mercy and your grace and your strength, through community, through this church. God, bless them today like never before. God, every single person in this room that would stop right now and say, Jesus, I give my life to you. Forgive me of those sins. I surrender to you right now. God, I ask you to receive them and begin to move them into a place of allowing them to feel your spirit like never before. Allow them to be obedient to your word. Put you first, to walk by faith and not by sight. God, to be able to be people of holiness, integrity, honest. Somebody say it. Come on, give it up to Jesus one more time. Give it up for all of our dads. Happy Father's Day. We love you guys. We have announcements, and we'll see you next week. God bless.
Hi, my name is Michaela Turner. Welcome to Encounter Church. Here are this week's announcements. Last Sunday was our first ever Hot Springs Village meet and greet. If you were there and joined us or helped volunteer, thank you so much for coming out. Next Sunday night here at Encounter Church at 6 p.m., we will have our first worship night of the summer. There will be an after party that will have food and games, so make sure to be here. VBS is coming the week of July 12th to July 15th from 6 to 8 p.m. If you would like more information, please contact Melissa at encounterchurch.tv. Our next Hot Springs Village meet and greet will be July 11th. At 6 o'clock p.m. at the Trademark Real Estate Building. Make sure to be there and bring a friend. We love seeing you all today. Have a great week, and we will see you next week. Bye!
Peace out.